out here.
Chronic beef. Well, he's in a bad humor. That fat Nazi, what I got a trouble because of him. Watch him. Get away from me, Hamlin. What's the matter?
Can't you see I'm talking on the phone?
Thank you. actually check and see if they still have some.
He works there.
Really?
He's PR. He has to deal with all the bullshit.
Oh, that's cool. Yeah,
good old
have you ever gotten to go inside? Like, nobody gets to go inside.
No, you can't go inside, but I've been out there. It's like a little commune. It's really cool.
It is cool. That's really amazing.
I really liked it.
Good old Adam.
Doesn't that stuff freak you out?
Yeah.
No, like that.
Yeah, no shit.
We videotaped our whole tour in Europe this last time.
Yeah.
That was. And it was great. It was really fun. But after a while, you kind of get used to it, and at first it's like,
yeah,
it's
running around and bent. Those are all people. All
people. I know, they were there last night.
I mean, they're nice play famous last night.
Yeah.
Where's it all there now?
We played this place called the Paradox. It's like the woman that
club,
did the Sun Club. Yeah, it's a Melt Club, exactly. Yeah. It was one of those places where you show up and you just go, oh god.
Very
good.
You know,
like,
very
good. Right in here. And those guys are all like really huge fans, but they're just all like,
they make them today.
Yeah.
They're here for the rock and the thrift show.
We heard that you guys played Yuma.
Yeah, that was really fun. Actually, except for Spoon played before us, and everybody thought they were us. I mean, because nobody knew who any of us were anyway. And so everybody like left except for the people who knew who we were. So it was kind of cool. We ended up playing this like huge room to like, I don't know, 50 people.
Yeah, my band plays there quite a bit.
Really?
Yeah.
I like it down there.
They take out to the dunes.
Yeah, that's right. Out there with keg guys.
They just like party out in the desert.
It was really weird because they like
had a
fire, you know? And I grew up in Montana, so when we had keggers, we'd have fires, but it'd be really cold out. And here we are, and it's just like, 100 degrees and they have a fire. You know, it's just like, whoa.
For light more than
Yeah, exactly. It's like, you know, what else do you do in a kegger but stand around a fire, you know? Like, I just thought it was really funny that they actually had a fire in the desert.
Yeah.
It's pretty universal, I guess. That's cool, yeah. What's the name of your band?
Skywall.
Skywall?
Skywall, yeah.
That's cool.
Power pop on here.
I like power pop.
Yeah. They got a record coming out in a couple days.
Are you putting it out yourself or do you have
Third World Underground, it's a new label here, they're from DC. Yeah.
Wow. And they say moved out here and
Yeah.
That's cool.
The guy's father's a diplomat, so he like started the label in Guatemala. All places.
Cool. Yeah, so. That's great.
Yes.
Oh, that's good. You don't have to put it out yourself. That's
Yeah. You just had to pay for recording.
That's not too bad. Yeah. Oh, that's cool. Yeah, we are lucky we never had to put our own records out. I mean, I know people would do it and it works really well, but we're just way too lazy.
You guys started off on Boner records?
We were on Boner pretty much. The first thing we ever did on vinyl was on Lookout. You know, it was one of that huge compilation.
You're on Floyd?
That's our first real recording ever.
So you guys came from Montana?
Dale and I grew up there, and Darren's from Seattle. We actually started in Seattle, and we split, like we were kind of part of that scene when it was really small, you know, but we were like, well, we're out of here, and we split just in time, because then we became huge, you know what I mean? I mean, assuming just in time that you don't want to become part of
some. So you guys are in San Francisco now?
Yeah, I like it there. Darren, like, lived in New York for a while, and then he's been living in Seattle again, but we get back together and practice. It works out. We don't all have to live together anymore.
That's cool.
It's just nice. Because I do. He and I have another band that we have that we do.
What's it called?
Milk Cult.
Yeah, I just bought that.
Yes. You have to be careful because some of the Milk Cult covers actually have Foreskin 500 on the inside. And so it's really like these guys from Phoenix were like, yeah, man, it's cool you guys have that Milk Cult record, but there's actually two different records, right? You know, I was like, well, yes, but that's a mistake, you know. It was the pressing plant.
Who's the guy that does all the films?
Frank Rowe,
He
lives in San Diego.
Red and Rosie?
Yeah. It's funny because Love God's not actually out yet. We released the soundtrack record first, you know, because he hasn't actually finished it yet, actually.
Yeah, I haven't seen
those. How long is that film? Yeah. It's like a real short little...
Red and Rosie is about 20 minutes, and Love God's supposed to be a feature, but when we did the work for it, the original work was for the trailer, like about 15 minutes, and...
Senator Mike.
And then...
Great show, man.
Nice to meet you.
What's your name?
Mike,
okay, I'm Adam.
Nice to meet you.
Go to the boss or something.
Yeah, really?
It's a lot of fun.
We have a night. If we have a day off next time we're here, maybe we'll like...
Yeah, next time you guys play. If you want to go, I can get you guys in for free stuff.
Cool.
Yeah. Yeah. See you guys later.
Thanks, Don. Frank is really cool. Supposedly he's got funding now to do a feature, so we'll go back into the studio and actually do a full whole soundtrack for it.
That's cool. Are in
just, it's me and Dale, the bass player, and then this guy Eric Holland, who's actually from Phoenix originally, but he like recorded our last two albums and that CD single that we did, you know. And
just something where the Rollock Pinchers. Was it DJ?
Oh yeah, actually, yeah, it was Mark Brooks, who's in Fortune 500, which is really funny that their records would end up inside ours. But yeah, he came and did some scratching for us, and Darren played some drums, and
it's actually pretty unusual.
Yeah, it is. It's kind of strange, but yeah, it's totally a noise kind of thing. Our next ones are going to be even weirder, but it's halfway done because it's all songs, right? But it's all guest vocalists, and like Mike Patton from Faith No More singing on it, and. Let's see. Oh, no, I totally am blank. Lars from Brodus. Eric produced that actually too. He's the other guy in the book, right?
Yeah.
And Carla from the Criminal Class is missing on it. I'm trying to get Buzz from the Melvins to sing a song. And so it's kind of noisy like that, but it's more like groovy, kind of, you know, almost dance, but not quite. It's too weird to be dance, you know what I mean? So. I'm kind of excited about that. That should be finished this summer. We like to keep busy.
That's cool. You guys got something new out right now?
Yeah, brand new album.
Just got it.
Okay, cool.
It's my favorite one yet,
actually. Yeah, they haven't
listened. Okay. Yeah, how much are?
I think we're selling for $10. Yeah. Okay,
that's cool. You guys got shirts and stuff too.
Yeah.
Okay, cool.
Same shirts as last time, right?
Yeah. Actually, the new shirts aren't. We were getting them shipped like to Austin.
You guys should print them on better quality shirts.
Aren't they good shirts? I don't know.
They're really thin. Pretty thin. Really thin.
Cotton. That kind of sucks because he still charges us a bunch of money for them. Really? So it's like I kind of don't really handle that. I just like let
them deal with it.
Yeah. I never wear them, but I mean, I guess they're probably just like this, huh? This is kind of cheap. Except it doesn't have pockets.
Yeah.
Black.
Black, yeah, black. It's kind of too hot here for black clothes, you know, but...
Yeah, now it is.
Definitely.
Yeah, you guys are pretty pale, man.
Oh, yeah. San Francisco is like...
Check out this skin.
It's white. White skin.
I don't really spend a lot of time in the sun, to tell you the truth.
You know? You don't have to here. It's like just walking around.
Yeah.
You walk across the street, man, you find a sunburn.
Yeah. I know. I mean, I imagine by the time we get through Texas, we'll be pretty burned up.
You guys are, like, on a full tour right now, or what?
Yeah, like 2 months.
For the new album?
Yeah. And it's the first time we've ever done it when the album came out, cool. Which is the way you're supposed to do it, right?
Yeah, but of course.
We totally never have done anything the way you're supposed to do it.
Well, it seems kind of cool if you, like, let the album come out and then go a little after it. So
yeah,
everyone knows the songs.
It's like
right.
Shigazi, they always... come here right before their album.
Right before. See,
every
tour,
they always
you don't know the songs.
Yeah. Well, the thing is if we did that, it'd be even worse because, but if we waited, let's say, another 2 weeks, we probably wouldn't play any songs from the new album. They'd be all songs for the next album. Because we're really inconsiderate that way. We don't care what the audience really thinks that way.
Goddamn,
I don't know if we care what they think, but if they, you know what I mean? That's not why we play, so.
I noticed that the first time I saw you guys here, it's like, I was expecting more songs I was familiar with.
Yeah, it's really, we probably get better reactions from the crowd, because then they can go, wow, I know that song, but we're pretty selfish like that.
I think actually the last time I saw you guys, I was on acid. So I don't think I really care what you were playing, just so long as it sounded cool.
Well, I imagine the way we play, it's probably a pretty good show to see if you're tripping, because it's all, half the time it's made up anyway, so it's like...
It's really cool.
Ed Hall's really fun.
That's great.
I've got them on videotape, too.
Really?
Yeah. As a matter of fact, I think I'll smack that on videotape. For you with this.
Oh, that'd be cool.
Yeah, let's go ahead and do that.
Get to watch it.
And that killer strobe light.
Yeah. the strobe light was like so intense.
Blinding.
Just the kind where it's like every time it goes, it leaves like a
trail.
Like, one of those disco, like the big club kind of.
Yeah, it was like when the Metal Supers played Phoenix, they had probably 1,000 strobe lights behind them.
Oh my god.
They had these two
They were too bright.
They went up and they just fucking strobe the whole audience. And you look out at it, like 1,000 people, like all.
Oh no, it's cool.
Yeah.
It's like, now they're touring.
Well, I guess they have the money for the fucking light show, their laser light.
They're going out with Stone Temple Gods or Stone Temple Pilot or whatever. It's like fully major labels.
schmooze scene with them now. I mean, they're still great, I'm sure, but it's kind of one of those things you go, I don't want to see it.
Yeah,
it's
kind of cool, but it's like, it seems like, don't those guys look a little too much like Alice in Chains?
Which
Stone
one?
Temple.
Stone Temple Pilots.
Yeah, it's any like band that like the first video comes out and the guy's fucking all muscly and doing like, that. I'm sorry. You know, I can't.
It's goofy too, because it's like, it seems like a lot of those like new bands like coming out, it's like they're all like heroin freaks or something.
Yeah,
it's like, they're
all like, it's pretty crazy. Fucking junkies.
It's that kind of part of that whole giant lie that they're just like dumping on everybody, that it's like everybody loves underground, so anything's underground, you know what I mean? Like somebody like Alice in Chains, that's like so far from what I've ever considered to be even remotely, but now it's like that weird twist where they go, the mainstream loves underground. And so underground must love mainstream, so it's all the same thing now. And it's not. It's not even close to being like that.
I think they're trying to make it really ugly. So like the more ugly, the more weird it is, and the more weird it is, the more appealing.
Yeah, right. Kind of. You know, but it's not really that weird is the thing. It's like, it looks weird and it looks crazy, but when you listen to it, it's still really weak and like whatever, you know. I mean, there are good bands out there, but those particular, all those major labels.
You guys are fucking good.
Well, thank you.
You guys are fucking rad.
Thanks a lot, man.
You guys play short sets.
Well, you know, it's really, well, whenever we come down here, it's always at the very beginning of the tour, so we're really out of shape. And I have 3 stitches in my finger, too, right now, so that it actually hurts like hell when I'm playing. It's just like, ooh, like I just cut my finger to the bone with a knife 2 days ago. It's just like,
it's not good.
This time particularly, it's because we've been doing these like almost 2-hour sets for like the last year almost, and we find that we're just like fucking driving everybody into the ground, you know. And so we decided to make them shorter, just consciously, you know, to change things. But I guess for you, like by the last time we were here, it was like short again. Yeah,
it was a year ago, man.
Yes, yeah, so
that last summer.
We've been waiting a year for this.
We
guys haven't been anything new in a while.
Yeah, it's been a couple of years.
Tuna Circus, and there's that.
The single, the single was kind of a cheating. We just wanted to go tour Europe, and they insist upon having something new, so we're like, well, okay. But then put out a single.
How'd you guys like working with that whole Tumor Circus thing?
That was really fun, but you know, we actually did that like over 3 years ago, you know? And it took Biafra like 2 years to do this. We wrote the entire thing and recorded it in like 3 days, right? All the music. And then it took him 2 years to do the vocals and get it out. So like when we did it,
vocals were the worst part.
Yeah, I know. See, the music, I love the music on that record still. Like I really like it a lot. But the vocals just make
it irritating. You know, his voice.
This is off the record. He knows that. I've told him. Like I'm pretty straight.
Was it a lot of reviews too? It's like, the music's great.
It's just like he's not a noise singer. Cool. You know, I know you're lying.
Well, it's that way for a lot of stuff. Like what he's saying with No Means No. It was like, I love New Wings.
But that just really didn't work at all, did it?
It didn't. It's like
the DOA one worked, though.
Yeah, I like that.
DOA,
like
the LARD thing worked, too. It's like, it just depends, I think.
Yeah, I think it really does. It's really just such a shame, because I like the music that we wrote and recorded. But then again, you see, like when we were mixing, I like engineered some of that, and he literally would do like 12 different mixes. Like, you know, I mean, you'd spend 2 whole days on one song. And then, when you're done, then you have to go back and listen to all of them and figure out, like, which one. It's like, by the time I was done, I was just like, fuck, man, this doesn't sound good anymore. It's just, like, killed. It's just like, I mean, we spent, like, I don't know, $25,000 in the studio. And when we recorded those first 2 days was, what, maybe $1,000.
Yeah.
You know, if we just left it, the vocals he did originally, and just mixed it, like, fast, I think it would have been pretty good.
Yeah.
Because I have rough tapes from the original, and it was kind of rough, and he was kind of, you know, it was like part of the whole thing, but then by the time it was overworked. But then also too, it was one of those things, like when we did it, it would have done us a lot of good in terms of publicity and stuff, you know, but by the time it came out, like, it really didn't matter anymore.
band because most people knew who we were. So
yeah,
most, you know, most people that would find out about Tumor Surface anyway.
Yeah.
So. Let's go pull that top.
Where'd you guys come up with that name?
Oh, that's a long story. There's which one? Which answer do you want? You know?
A.
My favorite one is you know, those true crime magazines.
Yeah.
And in the very back pages, sometimes they have this like cross reference thing of like crimes, and like mostly it's murder, and they have like scene of crime and weapon used and like number of occurrences, right? And there was one that was like steel pole in the bathtub, you know, and it was like, I don't know, like 10 or 20 occurrences.
Is that the real answer?
Well, of course not. That's a good one though, I think.
We always get asked that. What was it?
Scully Wall. What?
That's in our microbiology class, 357. That was in one of our interviews. It was like, where'd you get the name Scully Wall? Hacker said
it was,
that.
Well, it was
we all took microbiology 357C or something together.
I can't believe they printed that too. Yeah. That was really weird.
Is that true?
No, we got it from
it's from that book, Clockwork Orange.
Oh,
If you look in the dictionary, it means school. Everyone's going to school, so it's like totally cheesy.
That's totally cheesy. That's good though. That's great. At least it's simple, because ours is really. I mean, the truth is just. Oh, it's such a long story. I really don't even want to get into it, but it just really is meaningless. It's really boring. And like, you know, originally it was actually the Steel Pole Bathtub Sour Boot Voodoo Milk Cult. And we finally tried, you know, we made these posters, and the poster would be like the whole, it's like, it was just like, this isn't going to work. That's where Milk Cult comes
milk
from.
Milk Cult, yeah.
Because we're like, oh, cool. We're
I like that Steel Pole Melvin's Task Force.
Oh, yeah. That was actually, in essence, was the very first Milk Cult recording, because Eric, we kind of started it, and it would have been actually good if we had finished it, but, I mean, I think it's kind of terrible, actually, personally, but we ended up just, we had to go on tour, and I gave it to Eric and just said, here, you just put a bunch of samples on there and finish it up, you know, and so he did that. And the other one is the REM.
Yeah, I was...
That's actually a Milk Cult recording, too. That album is terrible, but I think our song's really good. Well,
it is one of the better ones on there.
I like the one you guys did. It's all like billiard balls.
Yeah, well, it's just like, it kind of, it's the only thing outside the fact that we do sample their song, like REM song, but on the original recording, it's like, you know, but in the beginning, there's like this really low rumble that goes, and I read in an interview or heard an interview like years ago where Peter Buck said that was them playing pool at, I don't know, what's his name, producer guy, whatever the fuck his name was, if I weren't totally spaced out from all that, and then they just slowed it down, right? And I always thought that was really cool, like really, you know, like back then I see already into sampling and stuff, and so that's why it's totally this inside joke, like, you know. Oh yeah, here's the song.
It's like time playing pool.
Yeah.
That's cool though.
You guys keep your sampler at it, I didn't even see it.
It's all really small tape decks.
Tape loops and...
Yeah, tape loops on cassettes. I mean, in the studio it's all computerized, you know, the whole 9 yards, but on stage it's too hard to take samplers on tour and too expensive, really.
You can't even see them, you just have them behind you guys? Or
they're actually on top of the amplifiers, but they're like only this big, so they're just kind of sitting there.
I think I saw one of them.
On your amp, right?
Yeah, I don't know where Dale Keats is. Actually.
There was one on the floor between the drums and the bass amp.
That was probably Dale's. Yeah. Oh, I know, that's a good idea. Because then you can get the foot switch farther out. That's a good idea, actually. I might cop that from you.
Put it on the floor.
Yeah. Or get an extension. That would work too.
I guess I should clean up.
Hey, well, good luck with your single and stuff. Skywall. I'm sure we probably will, you know.
Looks like everybody left, man.
I think they did. They're waiting outside for us to place it.
Steel pole bathtub!
I like that.
You guys are really cool, man.
Well, I'm glad you enjoyed it.
Is that an ab pad guide you're playing through?
Yeah. It's one of them.
Is that a tube head or what?
It has these weird tubes in it, but it's mostly solid state. Yeah. It has like a preamp tube, I guess. Maybe you open it up.
How sick is that? I have a guy.
So I wanted to get one of those cool, big, giant, old SVTs with tubes and stuff, but everyone I know has them. It's like, well, you should have two, so that when one's broken, you could use the other one. It's like,
I don't want to have to do it.